Chaos Group V-Ray 5 introduced a lot of interesting tools since the first release of the new frame buffer. Here, we'd like to present a video in which we're going to go through the post-production workflow to use with V-Ray 5 VFB. This first part is focused on the masking tools and how to set up the masks that we'll use later during the post-processing in the VFB. Note that the masking tools have been introduced in V-Ray 5 Update 1 in February 23, 2021. Make sure to have the correct requirements if you want to try them by yourself. Here, there's a render of the scene straight from the VFB with no post-production. We are going to improve it by using only the tools in the V-Ray 5 VFB and take advantage of the new masking tools. Note that I'm working with both the V-Ray GPU and CPU engines. The steps are the same in both cases, but there may be differences in the positions of some parameters. I'm also using ACES throughout the workflow. If you don't know how to use ACES in V-Ray 5, or you're not sure how to work with it, check out the presentation, ACES Workflow with V-Ray 5 from the Academy Days 2020. You'll need to register for the event if you are not already. It's completely free. And now, let's set up the masks. We go into 3ds Max and see how to configure everything. First, let's open the VFB. Then, to add a mask, go to Create Layer, and down below, you'll see three options. Integer Mask, Multimat Mask, Cryptomat Mask. The mask elements become active only if there is a color correction layer or folder selected. All the mask types are generated by render elements. In particular, the integer mask depends on V-Ray Material ID, V-Ray Object ID, V-Ray Render ID. The Multimat mask depends on the Multimat element. The Cryptomat mask depends on the V-Ray Cryptomat. Here are a few notes before moving on. For the integer mask, the render elements V-Ray Material ID and V-Ray Object ID must be set with output type to integer. Usually is set by default. For Multimat element, you need to set the red, green and blue IDs either manually from the render element or by using the script ID tool. The V-Ray Cryptomat works only with the image sampler set to bucket. So, for this example, I'm going to set the image sampler to bucket, and then I'm going to add the various render elements. Now that we have all the render elements, let's take an overview to see what type of mask they generate. V-Ray Render ID doesn't need any setup. V-Ray Material ID creates matrices based on the material ID's property of the meshes. We can easily replace it with either Multimat element or V-Ray Cryptomat. V-Ray Object ID needs an ID greater than 0, applied through the object properties of the meshes. To do it, you can either use right-click, Object Properties, Object ID, or you can use the ID tool script. V-Ray Cryptomat will generate masks based on the ID type we set in the render element. The options are node name, which means that matrices are created based on objects' names. Node name with hierarchy works the same as above, but it takes into account the hierarchy of objects, like groups. Node material name. This way, matrices are created based on the materials applied to the objects. Node user property. Mattis are created based on the property in node user property. Layer name, the Mattis are created based on the layers names in the scene. You'll notice that the V-Ray Cryptomat objects and V-Ray Cryptomat objects hierarchy are the same since I don't have groups in the scene. Multimat element works similar to the V-Ray object ID. It uses the object ID property of the meshes to generate masks stored in a red, green, or blue channel. In the same way as the V-Ray object ID element, you can either use the ID tool script, do it from the object properties, or from the parameters of the render element. You can also add multiple objects to the same ID, for example all the meshes, named glass. Remember that, since V-Ray object ID and multi-mat element use both the object ID property of the meshes, once you set the IDs, they'll basically generate the same masks. The main difference is that the multi-mat element creates RGB masks that are more easy to use in Photoshop. We can also generate multiple render elements for V-Ray Cryptomat and multi-mat element and then change the properties to get different variations in the masks. The masking tools can also be used to mask additional render elements, like V-Ray Reflection, V-Ray Refraction, V-Ray Specular, and so on. The masks are created and work in the same way, with only one difference. The mask layer has to be applied to a folder layer. It cannot be applied directly to a render element. If you're planning on using the render elements for the post-production in the VFB, a good starting point is to add the V-Ray back to Beauty. It will automatically create most of the render elements you need. It also solves another problem. To work with the render elements in the VFB, you need to be on the layer source composite, and with the V-Ray back to Beauty, we can quickly recreate the Beauty pass. To apply a mask, first we need to duplicate the render element and put it into a folder. Then, assign the mask to the folder in the same way we did for the other layers. For the post-processing workflow, I'm gonna use mostly the Cryptomat and Multimat masks. I've renamed some of the elements so it's easier to understand what type of masks are stored in the different elements. After launching the final render, we can start with the post-production. Here, you see the starting point in the VFB. First of all, I'm gonna add a filmic tone map layer set to type AMPAs and blending to lighten. This one will be applied to the entire image to add a little bit of contrast and increase the brightness of the image as well. Notice that, since I'm working in Aces, there is already a filmic tone map applied under the hood. I'm adding a second one to emphasize the effect. This may not be technically correct, but in this case, it's an artistic choice. If you're not working in Aces, the filmic tone map is mainly useful to remove all the highlight burns where the sun hits directly a surface and to add that cinematic look we all like. I'll also enable the lens effects and change the settings a bit. There are no right numbers here, it depends on what you like. During the post-processing workflow, you can also disable the lens effects so they don't distract you when applying other correction layers. Now that the base is ready, we can move on enhancing specific areas and objects in the scene. I'll start with the render elements since they affect the source image. This step could be even done before the filmic tone map and lens effects if you want to be precise. So, I want to increase the reflections on the moldings. First, let's find a useful mask. We have one on the MME ID tool 1 element. Then, duplicate the V-Ray reflection and move it above the Back to Beauty folder. Create a new folder, named Reflections Moldings, and put the V-Ray reflection element inside it. Once it's done, let's apply a multi-matte mask to the folder, and choose the correct element and channel from the list. Now, I want to add a little bit of specular reflection to the radiator, the lamp, and the plant on the left. With the same method we just saw, let's find a useful mask. Remember that you can also use multiple masks applied to a layer that contains everything you need. In this case, I'll use the V-Ray Cryptomat materials. This way, the specular effect will be applied only on the materials instead of the entire object. So, as before, duplicate the V-Ray specular and move it above the Reflections Moldings folder. Create a new folder. Name it Specular Enhance and put the V-Ray specular inside and apply the mask to the folder. The last step is to use the plus pick button to select the materials in the scene. Now, one last change with the render elements. I want to use the V-Ray lighting to increase the brightness of the floor a bit. The workflow is the same as before. We can use the Mask MMEID Tool 1 with the red channel. I lowered the overall power to 0.4 to make it more believable. I'm done with the render elements. We can move to the correction layers. I want to add some contrast to the curtain and the plant on the right. We can use either the curves or exposure layer. I usually prefer to use the curves. Let's add a curves layer, and with the V-Ray Cryptomat mask, we can isolate the plant and the curtain. Then, I can edit the curve graph with the classical S shape to create more contrast. We are almost done. Let's reduce now the saturation a bit on the plant on the left, but only affecting the leaves. At this point, you should be pretty familiar with the workflow. Find the mask, in this case the V-Ray Cryptomat materials is perfect. Then, create the hue saturation layer. Apply the mask to it and select the materials from the scene. Then, adjust the settings to your liking. Of course, we can go on the entire day doing post-production, but I think we can stop here. I'll only add a white balance layer set to 7000 kelvins to add a bit of warmth to the image. Please don't forget to re-enable the lens effects layer. Save the image as an EXR file to keep the bit depth, and we are done. As you can see, for certain post-production workflow, the new V-Ray 5 VFB is perfect, and we didn't even touch the light mix. I leave it to you to explore all the other tools that we didn't have a chance to look at in these articles. Here, you can take a look at the final result and a comparison of the before and after. Thanks for watching.